Hello, everybody, and welcome to the second day of the PGL Tavern Tales. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Lothar and Raven on the couch to bring you the action of the second day. But first, guys, how are you doing? How was the yesterday, actually?
I'm doing really good. Yesterday was kind of awesome. We got to see like the format we're all looking forward to see in full action. And yeah, I would kind of just enjoyed the last two series of the day more than anything. Hoi, 3-0, and we drew it twice.
That's actually a 6-0, and we had a 6-0 on coach as well, so it was kind of like a joke made true, finally. Right? But a very interesting day when it comes to the format. We didn't know exactly what to expect. Right? It's the first time this format is being used in current metagame. And I think it was a huge surprise for most of the players that actually Druid was doing so well. Mm. So that's the thing for day one, at least for me.
Yeah, Druid was definitely powerful. So for the viewers who are joining us right now, let's talk about the tournament format, how it works overall. We've invited 16 players, two qualified, four GSL groups, top two from each advances. So today we have the 8 players, double elimination, best of 5, and full reset for the grand final, which means that normally top 8 is single elimination. Here today we'll have 2 days to get our champion, and the champion who goes through the winner bracket will actually have a chance to lose, well, not really twice, but at least in the final, when he loses, he will have to, he can play another game. And we have a really good prize pool, $25,000 overall. First place takes $8,000. And everybody in this tournament is getting something, because even the players that got eliminated yesterday, they're getting $500 each.
Yeah, it's not a bad run at all for everyone. I mean, you can see the prize pool escalates quite dramatically when you get up to the top four, say. But yeah, it's not bad to come out, play a few games of Hearthstone, and, you know, try and make it through the groups. But worst case scenario, you're on 500, so not too bad at all.
I'm still saying that for most of the players, the prize pools are not really that important. They still want to have the champion title. Because when it comes to the players that we have here, of course, we have Tides, we have JJ, we have Adi, who are like already established DreamHack champions, right? But not JJ yet, but
yet.
But I think most of them are valuing the champion's title and the trophy itself more than the cash. It's like, you know, a bonus.
Yeah,
absolutely. Especially when you fight versus your friends and teammates, and we even have the first match is going to be JJ versus Crane. But before we talk about that, let's look at the groups and what happened yesterday, because some of those amazing players already got eliminated yesterday on Friday. So group A, B, C, and D, guys, what was the surprise? Who got eliminated that you were really surprised, at least in this group?
Yeah, so we see group A now, and you'd see like Angelo Shaggy, you know, definitely the underdog in this group, but it's very difficult to say because there's so many amazing players in this tournament. There's always going to be a tough call to who makes out the group. But again, like Kalento just dropping out was probably the big surprise. I think everyone expected a bit more of him here, you know, at least making it into the, you know, the next stage of the lower bracket. But,
yeah,
you know, Angelo Shaggy did a good job there taking down Kalento. I know that he lost a 6-0 in the next stage, but it's Crane and 6-0 that got out of group A. So again, so many good players in these groups, they're all stacked. It's very difficult to call anyone who would make it, but yeah, Crane and 6-0 doing a pretty good job overall.
I would really like to see Colento doing well in tournaments again. I mean, he's a great player, but he's streaming more than practicing lately, so maybe time to switch it up.
Yeah, possibly. Group B was actually on stream, and we had the surprise of Tassin, who got invited to this tournament because he was really good at DreamHack, and the previous PGL, he did really good as well. He's proving himself again, just getting out of this group, eliminating, well, not really eliminating anyone because he went for the winning bracket, but still, RDU and Ecop didn't make it. Super JJ joined Tassin as the winner here. Are you guys surprised by Tassin's performance, or did you expect Tassin to do good?
You know, I know Tassin's a good player, right? And, we've seen him perform very recently quite well. But when you're in a group with JJ, Ecop, and RDU, then Tassin is just the underdog based on, you know, history, past results and such. Obviously, Ecop just coming off an Insomnia win as well. But Tassin managed to go through the winner's bracket. The upper bracket, should I say. So he didn't even drop a set in this group as well. So that's extremely impressive. I'm looking forward to seeing what he can do today.
Yep. For me, the same... like group B, it had it two favorites, one player that should be doing well and one underdog, and I was sure that RDU and JJ would just go through, right? But stuff happens.
And then we have group C, where Orange and Stan Sivka made it through, where Stan Sivka is one of the previous DreamHack champions. He won in this room specifically, so Does it give you an advantage just playing at the same place again and be like, hey, I've won here already at least once?
I don't know. It might give it a little bit of confidence, but when you're in groups like these, there's you know, you can't feel there's too much of an advantage. Obviously, we see, unfortunately for Thijs, he got knocked out pretty brutally, to be honest, in this group.
He didn't win a single game.
No, that's and that's I know Thijs won't be happy with that performance at all, because he'll expect a lot more from himself. And, you know, I think we all do. But again, you know, Orange and Stan Sifka going through is a great pair to make it out of this group. And again, looking forward to seeing those guys play later on.
Yeah, I spoke with Thijs today during breakfast, and he was like, yeah, you know what? At least I learned something new today. I mean, yesterday. And at least it's a month before BlizzCon.
Yeah, so it's got time to really put the practice in.
Yeah, exactly.
And then we have the group D, the last group, where Life Coach and Hoi advanced. So even though RDU and Thijs didn't make it, Life Coach still is getting the G2 hopes on his shoulders, where Hoi is also another player from Na'Vi that advanced. And another Dane. So we have actually today in three groups, we have a player from Germany and player from Denmark facing each other. And then one group there is the player from Czech Republic and Sweden.
Yeah, it's a nice you know, representation from those countries as well. But I think this group was actually my favorite overall. Just the combination of Life Coach getting very stressed out at certain points, which is, you know, sounds harsh. I don't mean it in a bad way, but it's definitely fun to watch his reactions, especially like versus Garas or like all those secrets, trying to work out exactly how to play around them. And then Hoi doing the double 3-0 in the lower bracket at the end of the day. And what impressed me a lot about Hoi is he was the first to say versus Gara he didn't really play very well. He could have played a lot better. You know, he was a bit rushed at certain points playing that Druid, which is a bit of a problem. But then versus AK Wonder, he played so much better. He's a lot more confident, made his turns a lot faster, but still, you know, still played well. So, I was impressed with Hoi's sort of improvement from one set to the other, especially because he played one straight after the other as well. It was literally like the last two games of the day.
Yeah, absolutely. And here you guys can see who made it overall out of the groups and who got eliminated. Well, the tournament was absolutely stacked, so and there is no wonder that the players left are one of the greatest in the world, and the players who got eliminated, well, it was they're still super good, but
it's kind of the sort of positive and negative about this style of like the tournament with this invitational with so many good players is that you're always going to get a fantastic top eight. You're never going to be even remotely disappointed with the players you get.
That's correct.
But there's also players that you're going to be disappointed didn't make it through because everyone's great. So it was a cool day yesterday. I'm looking forward to see how we get on.
But the very important thing is that actually the format is a bit different because here we actually play 9 classes and the players ban one, then pick one, then ban two, pick one. So it's a different format there with a lot of strategy with picks and bans where the players just sit down with the spreadsheets and they go through everything. They try to figure out what to do, what to pick. And Lothar, do you like that format with like bans and picks?
I love it, to be honest. I love it because it kind of resembles the MOBA style of picks and bans, like an example in Heroes of the Storm. Because it's it allows you to kind of iron this strategy before the game. You're being prepared, but you don't have a set strategy because it's being affected by the way your opponent is picking and banning as well. So let's compare it to last year's standing. You prepare for a certain strategy, you always ban one class, you build your decks around that, and that's it. And you don't really adjust during the games, during the tournament. But here, you see the pick, you see the ban, and you're like, okay, so now I have to think about the nano bands, how they affect my game plan. So it's really complicated, but I think it's rewarding the players that prepared the most.
Yeah, I would actually just sum up this format based on what we saw yesterday. It legitimately allows Priest to be picked.
Yeah.
Which is something we saw yesterday. We saw some great performances from some of the Priest decks, like probably notably how to use Priest 3-0 in the first series of the day.
That was the first series
of
the day.
So yeah, it's kind of awesome just to see that this format opens up like multiple different class choices and deck choices as well.
This is very interesting because you can see the top classes performing still, because if someone bans Warrior, then we'll see a Shaman. If someone bans Shaman, then we'll see a Warrior.
Or Druid.
Or Druid. But in general, you see a wide array of classes, which doesn't happen usually in other formats. We'll have seen all of the top tier classes, so Shaman, Warrior, Warlock, but also the Paladin and the Priest with different builds, which is awesome to see in general in a tournament, to have a wide array of just the game, right? The meta game is really diverse in this format.
Yeah, the format is absolutely great. And two days of Hearthstone packed with Hearthstone action. Let's look at the schedule. What do we have today and tomorrow? So as you can see, yesterday we started with both groups. Some of them were played off stage, but today we'll have the upper rounds. Basically, Raven, what do we do today? We'll eliminate four people. At the end of the day, four people will actually be out of the top eight.
Yeah, so as we said, it is double elimination. So today we're going to play the first four matches in the upper bracket, and then the losers of those matches will then play against each other to move forward the lower bracket, and we'll decide which four players are going to not go home. They're still going to stick around, but be knocked out of the tournament for that. So we're going to have the eight games in total and sort of move us through halfway through the bracket to set up tomorrow for finals day.
And that's the bracket, guys. This is our bracket at the very moment. So the first match is going to be Crane versus JJ. Then we have Orange versus Hoy, Destin versus Sixo, and Life Coach versus Stansivka. One of those guys is going to be our champion, but we have 2 days to decide who's the best here.
Yeah, we're starting off with the sort of, as you mentioned before we went live, Lothar, the team kick down into the lower bracket. So Crane, JJ, both on Complexity, and both been performing very well recently. One of those is going to be knocked into the lower bracket at the start of the day, but all these matches look fantastic. I'm kind of looking forward to Life Coach and Sivka later on. Well, looking really good.
What's really fun is the fact that we didn't see half of the players yet on stream. We didn't see Crane, we didn't see Stansivka, we didn't see Sixo, we didn't see Orange. Those four players weren't on stream, and now we'll have to see what they're playing, which is really interesting, and we'll see maybe some different decks. What else? That's about it.
Yeah, I think we're definitely going to see different decks because everybody prepared 9 decks, and we've seen those changes in Life Coach deck, bringing this this weird rogue, which was like a lot of pro players actually commended him for bringing it. Really good versus aggro. What was the other decks that we've seen yesterday, which were a bit awkward and maybe on ladder, but in this format they really worked?
Yeah, I mean, some of the decks that stuck out were like the aggro paladin from the G2 guys. We saw it from RDU mostly, I think, in the first match. That's one that isn't normally taken. A lot of players are favoring Murloc mainly, and then just sort of a splash of Nazoth paladin there. But we saw all of those. We saw AK Wonder bring his Reno Lock with like the Leroy and Power Overwhelming combo
and the curator
as well. Yeah, so you know, there's a lot of different decks knocking around. Even there's a couple of slight variations on the priest list as well.
Yeah, well, the priest list was like, should I play 2 Kabbalah Shadow Priests or not? If they play Dragon Priest, right?
But the careful one, yeah.
It's still just nice to see a priest doing well in a tournament. And
definitely.
I'm not joking here, so.
Yeah, cool.
Not even
especially
joking.
Especially with the new skin. I'm excited to play the priest again with the new skin.
Isn't that a druid skin?
No, it's not. But JJ versus Crane, we actually had a couple of minutes to sit down with JJ yesterday and ask him a couple of questions. So let's see what he had to say.
My name is SuperJJ, I'm playing for Complexity Gaming and I'm from Germany. I think the tournament is great, the format is really like something different. It reminds me on the old Wire game format, which was really good. Everyone here is really nice, I'm having a good time. I just had some really awesome series. My first series didn't went quite well, I lost some favorable matchups. It didn't end well for me, but I think the loss I managed to recover again. I had a really tough series against Ecop, some really complicated matchups. I think I just played really well and also drew well and just came together, so I was able to qualify there. I have a different mindset to that. You can't go into a tournament and expect to win it. Like, it's still a card game. What my expectations to myself are like playing my best, playing to my outs, improving myself. Like, this is the mindset you should have in this tournament, I think. There are really good players here. I always love when I'm facing someone analytical, like Life Coach, because it's always very tense. Also, like Stansivka is a really good player. These are like players I really respect. I think Hearthstone is going into, since Standard, into a better direction than before. I want still like these RNG swings to disappear, like Yogg-Saron, Tuskar to Temmik. It's a bit too much. I think we also need more control and combo decks again, just that skill matters more than a Yogg swing or Tuskar to Temmik. Enjoy the series and have fun, I guess.
And that's JJ. I think those were wise words. And you know, JJ also he won a couple of tournaments before. He had a good performance overall. So do you guys think JJ is going to take this one, or is it going to be Crane?
It's really difficult to say. I will say though, like what JJ said about going into tournaments with the mindset of, instead of saying, oh, I'm gonna win this tournament, it's I'm gonna play my best and like play the best possible, and if it happens, it happens, is like completely the correct mindset to have. And I think JJ is probably the one of the most successful players when it comes to like through Swiss brackets as well. Yep. He just always crushes through the brackets sort of very consistently. So, you know, it seems to have a good mindset to have, but Crane is no pushover either, and they are teammates as well. So
yeah, like we've seen Crane for the first time at PGL, I believe. Like he was obviously playing before, but PGL was his big tournament where we thought he's going to win it. Unfortunately, he got knocked out, but then he qualified for HCT. He ended up in the final of DreamHack Valencia. But we actually was able to talk with Crane as well a bit, ask him a couple of questions. So let's see what he has to say.
My name is Simon Roundhorst. I'm from Denmark. I like the format of the PGL tournament. Basically, what I've experienced recently is that whenever you force people to play the not best decks, the players who are the best really show themselves. You force people out of the comfort zone. You force them to think for themselves. Like, it's not all these pre-made decisions where you've done it 1,000 times maybe. When you have to play some of the weaker decks, it's really, it's so interesting for me. And also, the weaker decks are the decks that tend, in general, tend to go longer. And the longer games go, yeah, the more skill-based it is. Another thing about the format as well is variety of strategies, because it's so complex with all the decks and the bans that are possible. It's just interesting to see what people are bringing. I thought people would bring one thing, but already in my first match, I had a guy pick Colenso pick Mage against me as his first pick, which is like, can you do that? I also don't think it was the best idea, probably, but it was an interesting idea, I guess. My group was what I've been calling the group of death, basically. Myself, Colenso, and Sixo in one group. That's a rough one. Fortunately, I managed to beat both Colenso and Sixo. I guess, unfortunately for me, I had to play Colenso in the first one. I would have obviously preferred to play Angelo Shaggy. I'm really happy I beat Sixo and Colenso because they're obviously very strong opponents. And particularly Sixo is on a complete roll recently. And he managed to beat me twice in a row in a team tournament we played. Both of them were 3-2 and both of them came down to Murloc Paladin Mirror. Fortunately, I didn't have to play that against him this time. I'm not afraid of any opponent ever. Yeah, it's not a healthy way of thinking about it. But I guess the opponents that I consider the strongest are Sixo, obviously, and then probably my teammate JJ. There are a lot of good players, but nobody in particular I think stand out compared to those two. I don't know how much I like the whole banning cards thingy. It's like the community standing together as a whole against cards like Yogg-Saron and Tusk of the Totemic, telling Blizzard, listen, we don't want this crap in our game. But as for in the future, I don't hope that tournaments are gonna need to ban cards, and I don't hope that's the direction. Because then, where do we draw the line? I want to compete with the cards that are being played on ladder. Like, that's the game. I don't want to be playing some alternate game where we completely change the rules and we take cards and say, no, let's not play with those. Because then it's going to become like super casual tournaments, in my opinion. You have to make sure that this is like, we're actually competing in this game. We're serious. And the rules are, to some degree, they're gonna be the same. We're gonna play with the card pool that's available. Maybe banning cards is viable, I don't know. I'm not sold on it. I don't think I like it. I enter any tournament thinking that I can win it all, but you have to look at how likely it is. And I think now that I'm top 8, yeah, probably a bit more than 1 in 8 to win. I don't know how much, and it also doesn't matter. I think the way I've always approached it is just like one game at a time. If you expect that, oh, I need to get out of my group, well, you're playing a card game, you can get unlucky. You're just setting yourself up for disappointment and stuff. I just prefer to just always try to perform the best that I can. I would like to think that I always do, but it's obviously not the case. I mean, I'm also a human. That's how I like to approach it, like just play the best every time and eventually the wins will come. Maybe it's not this time, maybe it's another time, but you know, they will come. Like, I've been to Romania quite a lot of times. I think it's like fourth or fifth time this year already. Obviously, I haven't visited the country in the like as a real tourist. Every time I've been busy like playing tournaments, I don't feel like I really truly know the real Romania, but everything that I've been exposed to has been kind of cool. It's pretty cool that you go here and everything's so cheap. For my next opponent, I just want to say good luck, have fun.
That was pretty interesting. So, did you guys have a chance to learn about the true Romania?
I spent like a whole week here. First DreamHack in 2014. I spent the entire week with my wife.
How was it?
wandering around. It was cool. We actually had a Kriparian as a guide. Because, you know, he's Romanian. We visit the entire city and we're like wandering around museums. And there's like an entire museum that has village huts from different times in Romania. Pretty cool site.
Oh, nice. And also I want to ask you guys about the cards that Quinn was talking about, because he got asked about task cards to Tamik and then Saran. What do you guys think about it and card bans in tournaments?
It's a real tough one, isn't it? Excuse me. I understand what you're saying about the ban's not really being the long-term answer, but it's very difficult to see what people are going to do about it in terms of whether they actually want to remove cards, nerf cards, or anything like that for tournament play. So it's a real tough one. I completely get what Crane's saying, though, that it might not just be the long-term answer.
In usual card games, in traditional card games, you don't see bans because they're being a really last resort. But we live in a digital card game, so making errata or just nerfs would be more suitable in our environment than just banning a card, right? But I feel like maybe it will happen in the future, maybe not. It would be cool to see. But so far, I'm enjoying tournaments when there's more diversity in decks in general, like this one. Even though we have cards like Tasker Totemic, like Crane said, and Yogg, which are very, RNG heavy, you still see a wide array of games which you don't see on ladder.
I do agree with you guys. Like, personally, I'm fine with having a tournament like Badstone from time to time to see it as something absolutely different. But I would not like to see it as a trend so that every tournament tries to ban cards. I'm fine with an extended class ban system as we have right now, or maybe even make it a bit different, have two bans in the beginning, then one pick. But definitely, I'm a purist like Crane. I kind of want to play the game that developer is publishing.
And I think as well, like the overall format of the tournament, of the group stages into Double Elim, is you play so many games that you'd hope over that volume of matches you can play that any sort of shenanigans from cards we might not really like at the moment sort of gets evened out in the long run, just because you're going to naturally play more games than you would if it was single win, for example.
Yeah, that's true. Well, let's hope for some balance patches in the future.
Fingers crossed.
All right, so we have the bans and picks, and for the ban phase, JJ is banning Druid and picking Druid, and then Crane is banning Shaman and picking Shaman himself. So it shows how the players, they favor, which class they favor. It's like, all right, Shaman is the strongest. I'm going to ban it. I'm going to pick it.
It's really interesting to see that we have actually six different classes.
Yeah. Yes, we do have six different classes in this specific match.
So Shaman, Druid, Hunter, Mage, Paladin, and Rogue, which is super super diversified. And we don't know anything about Crane decks, but the players were given all the deck list after day one, so they have the full information what is happening and they can prepare in the matchups, which is also very interesting because now the picks and bans are very thoughtful, right? They know exactly what to do. It's not like a guessing game day one.
They have full information where in the beginning they didn't. They only knew some of the things that were shown on the stream. That's why also they got all the lists right now, because we've streamed Group B and D and Group A and C not. So we want everybody to have the same advantage and like fair playing field. Can you guys take me through the second pick as well? Who won there?
Well, it's a really interesting one because although like we ourselves don't exactly know Crane's lists, I know he's played a lot of Freeze Mage in the past as well. So the second pick is going to be lined up like pretty okay versus the rest of Super JJ's lineup, but the Druid's a problem. We were speaking yesterday about how Druid can just absolutely demolish Freeze Mage. So if that's the case, then JJ's got a pretty clear counter pick into Air Freeze Mage, unless he just picks Druid first. And then Crane has to try and work his way around and have the Freeze Mage as a pick later on as a counter.
It's really interesting to see that if Crane is playing a Freeze Mage, as you're saying, why would a Rogue be picked by JJ, right? Because it's a really bad pick into the Freeze Mage. But at the same time, he also has a Druid. So it's very interesting to see the first game, because it will majorly shape the way the game will resolve as the entire match. So very interesting to see which pick will be the first choice for both of those players. If I have to guess, I would say that JJ will most likely open with Hunter, because it's a decent class against every single one apart from Shaman. It's like Shaman is kind of a favorite against the Hunter because it's more aggressive, and has just better minions.
It's still better than, I think, Rogue versus Shaman. So I do agree with you that Hunter is probably the safest pick overall. It has like okay matchups versus, if that's a Freeze Mage, okay matchup versus Freeze Mage, mm-hmm. okay matchup versus Paladin, and then versus Shaman, you still have a better matchup than Rogue. Yeah. Unless the Rogue is built
in
like
before Lash the Rogue. Mage is actually tempo.
Yeah.
All this whole conversation is like, never mind, it's tempo mage.
This is why they have better information. It's really hard to estimate what is better in this format because the players have so much more information than us.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Well, we know for sure that none of them picked Priest, even though Priest was not banned. But the game is ready. Take it away, guys, and have fun.
Thank you, Nimcha. And the first game, Rogue versus Paladin. So, two different picks that we didn't anticipate as the openings, mm-hmm. right? So players are playing some mind games here. So far, the JJ's Rogue looks pretty normal. We didn't see any card that is standing out. And for Crane, I'm guessing there will be anything can happen.
Yeah, I think so. I know Crane's played this deck a few times before, so it wouldn't surprise me too much. There's still a chance that it's just, say, a more standard in his off list, because mm-hmm. You know, all these cards are, you know, pretty reasonable, but now we start to see Ivory Knight. And even Loot Hoarder, I guess, isn't too common in the Zoth, even though it is a death rattle. So I'd imagine it is anything. And this is going to be an interesting one, because a lot of the time, Rogue can just like pressure the Paladin pretty hard and then finish the game with a good amount of burst. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We'll get to see if JJ is playing the Quest Adventure version, which becomes a little bit more difficult to navigate, because you kind of want to put the Quest Adventures down to either bait out an equality or wait for after the equality and use it as a win condition to finish the game.
Exactly. Fortunately for Crane, Paladin has one of the few classes. Is one of the few classes that has actually an answer to concealed minions because of the equality mm-hmm. pyromancer or equality consecration. And so far, Crane already has the equality and the consecration in his hand, so he has an answer to a concealed gadget, an example, or concealed questing adventure, as I said. But we also have got information that he is playing Anything Can Happen, which usually is just a straight out win because the Rogue has no way of stopping it.
Yeah.
Right? There are no taunts, they have no heal, so what can you do?
Yeah, I think it'll be important in this matchup for JJ to actually put on some minion pressure, and Tomb Pillager is going to help with that, and then maybe, you know, a decent size Van Cleef or something along those lines, Quest Adventure as well, to force out all could removal that you don't mm-hmm, really want to use, mm-hmm. and then suddenly, if the equality clear is used on those, then Gadget Zan becomes extremely safe, so then you can get the full cycle out and then just burst your opponent down from there. But we'll see how the game goes, because like you said, Crane's actually already got a clear, and he's got Aldor Peacekeeper, which is very important if a big Van Cleef came out.
Yep, that's correct, and he has few answers. What is lacking is card draw, and this is really problematic, because usually you need the card draw to keep up to the game of your opponents, especially if they're playing an aggro deck. You'll be if you have answers, at some point you just run out of steam, and your opponent will be still drawing aggressive cards, and you're like, well, what do I do now? I don't have anything else in my hand, right? So it's very important for Crane to pick up the card draw at some point. Not yet, because he has still time, so the mana will be used as answers in general, but it might be going more rough in the future.
Yeah, I mean, already this board, although not representing tons of power, is proving a bit of a problem, mm-hmm. because Crane, well, maybe less so now, but Crane kind of has to deal with this board, but when you start using Consecrates now on just, you know, Thalnos, a Aldored Tomb Pillager and the SI, then it's not really a great Consecrate. You don't want to equality this because there's much more important targets, but you're also taking damage every turn, mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. very difficult choice. Now, the True Silver Champion is definitely going to help. You can just clear up the SI and then hold off for a turn, and then maybe start to, you know, you pick off the rest of the minions afterwards with the other charge of the True Silver.
It would have been definitely harder without that True Silver Champion, because he would probably use the Blugel Warrior, just weaken up a minion and play Consecration next turn. He will get some damage this turn and will slowly stack up. So an Ivory Knight would have to be played most likely in turn 7 after the Consecration. But now he can be slower. Now he draw also the Acolyte of Pain. He can be he can also be just pressuring his opponent with the Hero Power. So he doesn't lose card advantage, which is very instrumental in this matchup.
Yeah, I think there's a there's a couple of options for Crane here. He's going to go for the Ivory Knight, though, Tristan, and what's he going to get? Anything crazy?
Well, I mean, Forbidden Healing is not bad.
Yeah, I'm...
you don't heal.
I'm looking at humility as well. It's definitely something to consider, because you've already used one Eldar and a Tomb Pillager, mm-hmm. and having more ways to just completely negate rogue damage, like, perfect timing. Good yep. work. What if there's a cold blood to actually, and then you can just negate that effect straight away with a second humility. But I suppose at the moment, Crane doesn't really have too many any heals available until that Forbidden Healing came out. So I don't mind the pick there at all, just to guarantee you've got a heal after this Ivory Knight.
What is very important for Super JJ is the fact that he knows now that the card picked up from the Ivory Knight is actually Forbidden Healing, because it's a zero mana card. Paladin doesn't have any other zero mana cards.
Yep, so he does have that knowledge available to him, which is going to help in terms of controlling how much burst he wants to do and how much pressure he wants to set up on the board. But here's the gadget, Zam, and with the conceal as well. So this might be the turn that draws out the equality. And if it is, we can see there's already Barnes, there's Edwin in hand. He's got cards he can combo with Backstab Eviscerate, for example. So straight after this, if he chooses to, JJ can just make a huge Venkleaf and say, mm-hmm, okay, mm-hmm. How do you deal with this now? You've only got the one charge of the right? True Silver. You've used a Peacekeeper, and this is the presumption that he uses equality this turn as well. So, and how can you not? Can you leave a gadget Zan up? And even the 5-1 Thalnos is doing work.
The 5-1 Thalnos is actually a bigger threat than the gadget Zan right now.
Yeah, it's just the spell power plus the spell just power the raw
plus
damage.
5 attack,
yeah.
That's actually quite a lot. Let's say there's one Eviscerate, that's already 10 damage.
Yeah, and these are the awkward situations I was talking about earlier where you kind of have to use your equality here because there's no good way to deal with this board. Mm-hmm. But then suddenly after one equality has gone so early in the game as well, JJ can be much more open with his turns and just really refill up the board, because you're really not expecting another full board clear again. Mm-hmm.
But now we see different type of answer.
Oh, he's going for the Consecrate. That's way better, actually.
It's way better, that's true. But the one thing is that he can't really play his Acolyte of Pain this turn, mm-hmm. which was possible if he went for the equality. But as I said before, what do you do with the Edwin, right?
Yeah.
So he kept the equality to have the answer for the Edwin.
Yeah, and I think the only reason that was done is because he already has the Consecrate and a Bluegill available. Mm-hmm. So he has ways to use the equality on the same turn he's played it and actually either clear the board or pick off a big minion. We are going to see JJ go in on this Venkleaf by the looks of things. And another pretty huge board for him, but we can see that there is equality and Consecrate available. So Crane being sort of really disciplined there, not mm-hmm. doing the not mm-hmm. doing the easy play, just clearing the minions up and holding on to that equality as long as possible.
Yep, correct. Unfortunately, again, he will be at 2 mana instead of 3, so Acolyte of Pain will be still sitting in his hand if he goes, of course, for the equality consecration. Other options are equality Bluegill Warrior into Edwin, smash down the Barnes with the weapon, and then you can develop still something on the board, which is nice. Or you can even use... that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I think the Consecrate is going to be used here, and just hero power and sort of just deal with it for a turn, because now that the War Lead has been drawn, it's very nice to be able to Bluegill War Lead on the same turn and get the mm-hmm. buffed attack. Mm-hmm. There's, the Bluegill actually does 4 damage when it's buffed by the War Leader, and 4 damage kills a hell of a lot of rogue minions. So it's really nice. It's just a 5 mana. One, you get the Murlocs on the board for them to be killed, which is what you want in anything, but also you get them killed in a very, very efficient way.
Mm-hmm. Also, using the hero power, the Paladin's hero power here is actually great, because your opponent has a deadly poison weapon, so most likely he doesn't want to use his weapon against a 1-1.
Yep. We see JJ here going in, just playing Leeroy with the Fan of Knives, able to clear up the Drake, so make it a little bit more difficult to deal with. Just going full face and saying, right, you kind of need to heal now, because for all he's got the rest of the burst in hand. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the time, the only heal coming out is either going to be Ragnaros Light Lord, which can be sapped, which is a bit of an issue, or really Forbidden Healing. But then how much do you heal with Forbidden Healing? Because if you go for, say, the full 18, well, it's great, but you've just handed Rogue another turn.
You don't need to go for the full 18. Here, the Bluegill Warrior can answer the Leroy Jenkins. You can think about playing the Acolyte of Pain and then healing for 8, which puts you on 18. You did see one Cold Blood already. You didn't see yet any Eviscerates, but you have seen Leroy. So the burst damage that is being left for the deck is actually only 4, 8, 12, and you can buff it by spell power. So I feel like at 18, you're kind of safe.
I think actually, like, Bluegill, Doomsayer, Forbidden Healing, because then you kind of remove the turn that your opponent would gain by playing Forbidden Healing because you're playing Doomsayer. And you don't really let them develop any minions on the board, or if they do, then they have to kind of, like, sap, which is just, you know, not too great for them.
Well, we'll see what his option. No
down.
Heal. Interesting. No heal and a war leader. So why would you do this? Let's think. Let's say there's a sap on the Doomsayer and your opponent develops a minion, then you still have a free attack minion on board, which is nice. So I'm guessing this is the way of thinking for Crane here, and it will work pretty well because it will draw out either a Eviscerate or a Shadow Strike for some of the minions.
Yeah, the sap on the Murloc's kind of awesome. It just makes it so awkward because when you don't have your full Murloc package like already binned, then you know playing anything is 10 mana, right? You know it's your whole turn. So when you have to sap the wall lead, it means, okay, I used 3 mana to play it last turn. Now if I want anything to happen, I need to play 3 mana again and then wait another turn. And every single turn that JJ is buying on his rogue here is just more turns to draw into the damage and really pressure him, because now I feel like Forbidden Healing just has to happen, right?
Mm-hmm. Also, we didn't talk about the Echoing, the Swamp Ooze here in the rogue deck. Interesting deck choice, right?
Yeah, I mean, again, in this format, it means you can kind of if you're expecting to be able to play rogue, it means you can kind of like leave open more weapon classes, right? You know, there's even levels of thought of what tech cards you have versus what classes you leave open, which is pretty cool. When you come to banning so many classes out, you kind of corner your opponent into picking very specific classes that you want them to pick. I think that's how a lot of players have approached this.
Yeah, I agree about that. And he's pressuring the Paladin, but unfortunately, he's not really doing a great job at it. Now one of the minions can be killed with the help of the Keeper of Ulduman. Dealing 5 damage next turn doesn't really help that much. Hit the Paladins will be still at 15, maybe 14. Oh, it's not looking good for JJ. He needs card draw.
Yeah, just a lack of card draw is ruining him here.
But another sap.
Yeah, it's going to delay the War Leader. Because something very realistic at this point, everyone, when you initially think of anything, it's you know, the stupid like 20 odd damage combos and stuff. but a lot of the time, you could just use it if there's just one Bluegill, one War Leader played, and then just cycle it. Because as you can see, Super JJ is getting relatively low on health, and it might just be enough that you're edging towards drawing a second anything, that even with such a small first one, you're going to gain enough with the second one to finish out the game.
Yep, correct. But even there's a ton of options for Crane to be actually drawn. Like, either he needs more Murlocs, or he just needs heal.
Yeah.
Heal basically acts like a finisher here, because the rogue is running out of steam. And
this is where I think we might see, yeah, I was going to say, we're going to see the Avis used on the Keeper, purely to get as much sort of juice out of this as your Drake as possible. He's just you need the repetitive minion damage, and this is why he's just ignoring the Acolyte. He just doesn't care anymore. He needs the minions to get more and more damage on instead of the one-off Eviscerate.
This is the this is the correct way of evaluating how do I win the game. How persistent damage will the minion will get me, right? Instead of just keeping the Eviscerate in my hand as a face finisher, as a projectile. And the answer is, you need to use the projectile as a board control tool and rely on a minion to be dealing consecutive damage.
Well, there's no point of having 5 damage in hand if you can never get him to 5, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I really like the play, and we're going to see the Solemn Vigil pickups actually super nice for Crane for the next few turns, just because it means he can now empty his hand and then cycle in to more stuff later on. So still, Crane looking pretty good here, and JJ just lacking the card draw. There's the Auctioneer, but
one turn too late.
Yeah, with nothing else to play.
One turn too late, and you can't really play it right now. If you play the Auctioneer right now, you basically you're sacrificing any kind of combo that you can do next turn. But at the same time, you're at 17 life, and there's 3, 6, 7, 8 damage on board. So if you play Gadgeton next turn, you might be already dead.
Yeah, but you've got to just think about what the outs to win, and he needs to hold on to Gadgeton here, especially because what Gadgeton dies to.
Oh, nice.
It's like okay.
Angel Blade Master kind of
dropped changed
in.
The game.
No, he's like, yeah.
It's
know
now
what?
Priest versus Mage, everyone. There we go, we're back.
And he was like, I'm going to just hang out here.
The problem, sorry, as I was saying, was like Gadgetzan Dice like oozing a hero power as well, which mm-hmm. is not, it doesn't even trade for anything good. And Ragnaros Lightlord more than likely gonna be the you know,
the name the coffin.
Yeah, that, there you go. I was working out which one I wanted to use there, but that's a pretty good one, Lothar. Yeah, it's pretty much gonna end the game here. Is yeah, that's a kind of a rough one for JJ. He just sort of ran out of juice towards the mid game there and couldn't get enough work done.
So let's kind of make an analysis of the early games, early turns. Why did Crane win the game? And I feel like the answer was because he made a really good choice of using the Pyromancer Consecration to keep the equality, to have an answer to the second wave of threats from JJ, and that allowed him to not rely on card draw because he was outvaluing the rogue in the beginning.
And also, as well, combined with the Forbidden Healing he got from Ivory Knight, because he didn't draw any of his own. He didn't draw any heal, right? There was only the Ragnaros right at the very end, and then, yeah, true Silver Champion as heal. But the Forbidden Healing pick was pretty key.
How much did he heal from the Forbidden Healing?
Was it...
I think it's 16, because he used the Doomsayer and then played the Forbidden Healing on turn 10. So,
yeah.
So that was 16.
Oh, no, did he play the War Leader as well?
No, that was the turn before.
Oh, yeah, because it got sapped.
So,
right, yeah.
In general, he got 16 heal from Ivory Knight when the maximum was 10 from it, usually, right? So, yeah.
Kind worked of out pretty well in the end, but we are on the next game now, and we will sort the overlay issues out pretty quick, guys, but it's going to be Hunter for JJ. This is a much nicer matchup to play, I feel.
Is it?
As the Hunter?
Yeah, because I'm like not sure every time I play it.
Really?
Like,
I just think you have so much consistent damage that's super awkward to deal with. Paladin never has really a nice, clean board clear because of all the death rattles of the Hunter. Mm-hmm. You can see the Wolf is the easy example that's available to see now. But already look at the pressure, and there's not really many early cards from Crane that can actually deal with these minions. And yes, we are sponsored by HP. Guys playing on the Omen laptop.
I didn't know.
Well, just in case, there was a huge HP logo for you there. So we are sorted out now, guys. Sorry about that, but we are, you know, very early in the game. Nothing too crazy happened. But yeah, as I was saying, there's not too many minions that can deal with the early pressure Hunter can put out here. We see the Acolyte was picked over the Loot Hoarders there early on, just to try
Which
and cycle. And yeah, because Loot Hoarders normally great because it trades with so many, mm-hmm. you know, so many of the Hunter drops, right? But
on the other hand, keep being better on curve might be just instrumental to the win for Hunter.
And to be fair, there was a fiery bat down, right?
Yes.
So a one drop killing you two drop never feels great, especially with the plus one damage as well.
Yep. True.
But already JJ's starting to stack up the pressure here with the Wolf and the Toad down. And this is the kind of the issue I was meaning. Like, what's the play if you true silver one of these, then you take in the damage, then the next one hits you, and then you know it's going to be followed up by, at worst, like hero power and maybe a two drop, you know? So it's going to feel a little bit awkward for Crane at this moment in time.
Kind of a set for him. So I don't blame him for playing the two Loot Hoarders because, first of all, he needs to dig for answers. Even an Ivory Knight will help him a ton on turn 6. Turn 5 most likely will be just the True Silver Champion to have some tempo on turn 5 as well. Tempo on turn 6. So you can playing a minion that will heal you will be actually ideal. Having a double card draw will be really helpful for him.
Yeah, this is kind of a bit of a janky turn here from JJ, just having to bow on 4 and that's it. Never feels fantastic, but what he's doing is just preserving the minions on board so he can continue to pressure. Like we said, repetitive minion damage is super key in the matchup, just to try and really put the Paladin down as low as possible and force him to make those awkward turns where it's like, okay, I guess I kind of have to Forbidden Healing, but as we said, that card uses all the mana you have available left and pretty much passes the opponent another turn.
Yep. The Doomsayer, too late. Like, the difference between drawing it on 4 turn 2...
Oh, is
like
ridiculous.
Night and day, right?
Almost unmeasurable.
Yeah.
It's going to come down, though, because all what this does is actually just force... a response from JJ to you know, at least some extent. He kind of has to kill the Doomsayer because Hunter needs to develop minions every turn almost all the time. He needs to keep that pressure up, and the kill is actually kind of awkward, but what he can do is just trade into the Acolyte and Deadly Shot if he really wants and still weave in a hero power.
Does he need the Deadly Shot for any other target?
Yes.
for Ragnaros.
If there's a Tyrion, a Ragnaros.
Yeah.
But the problem is, by using Deadly Shot now, he might not need to deal with a, yes. you know, an issue that far down the road. Because look at the pressure.
That's
next
correct.
Turn, he can go for the Animal Companion or the Hero Power, or he can just get the Tiger on the board. And Tiger's ridiculous. It requires an equality to clear for its first turn because mm-hmm. of the stealth. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you're really representing some huge threats to the Paladin here. And, you know, I actually like the Deadly Shot because the idea is, because he has Call of the Wild as well, he's going to end the game before Ragnaros even matters.
That's correct. And Crane had a... Crane hope was to heal for 7 with the Doomsayer, but unfortunately it just did draw a Deadly Shot, which didn't heal him at all, or act as an armor. And he still has 2 threats on the board, and I feel like he's being pushed to use the Pyromancer Consecration to deal with the entire board.
Yeah.
And maybe still have the Pyromancer.
Yeah, I agree. I think he has to, because everything else doesn't feel good enough at 16 health versus mm-hmm. Hunter. Mm-hmm. When Crane disagrees. He's going to use the True Silver. He does get some healing from
it's
this.
Ballsy.
Yeah, he does get some healing, which is fine. And turn 6, you're expecting high main. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like, the general best turn 6 play for the Hunter isn't actually one that does more than 3 damage to you this turn. Oh, Kill Command as well. That's a lot of damage.
11 damage this turn, but he doesn't want to do that. That's for sure.
This is a tough call. You could go for just the like trying to optimize your mana in terms of like Animal Companion, as well as weaving in Hero Power. But Stranglethorn Tiger is an almost guaranteed 5 damage. So you bank on that next turn. Next turn he has Kill Command and Quick Shot to push even more damage, and this is very, very difficult. Ivory Knight might be the saving grace here for Crane if he can like get one of the high cost cards to come out to
like
really heal.
Anything can happen. I mean, it
pretty much,
be bad,
yeah.
Right?
Lay on Hands wouldn't be too terrible.
Yeah, Lay on Hands. Anything can happen. Those cards would be really helpful. Ragnaros would be actually helpful as well because it's a Paladin card, so you can get a second copy. But, wow, if you would play the Pyromancer Consecration...
Can he summon Vigil if he does that? Because it'll clear, it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, he'll have 1 mana to play the Solemn Vigil, right?
But why would you do that in this case? I don't feel like this
cycling to those Forbidden Healings, Lothar. Yeah, it's too much damage with the Tiger on the board. I was just trying to do the Solemn Vigil maths.
Too much mana, I feel like, anyway.
So, 6 damage available on the board. There is a Kill Command as well, and that is going to clean up the game, I believe.
Oh, that's Versen with Desert Camels.
Yep.
That actually puts even more win rate for the Hunter than without, like, against the Paladin.
Yeah,
he doesn't have any
one drops, yeah.
Right? So you push a Desert Camel on the board, and you get, like, additional 3 damage from it,
yep.
At least.
Yep, kind of awesome, and we see JJ there just take a very, you know, snap pick Hunter and pretty much do exactly what he wanted to do in that game. And as I said, I think the rough part for the Paladin versus Hunter is that it normally just doesn't. It's built to go late game, mm-hmm. so it just doesn't have enough answers for the early minions that you know you're gonna have to face, and the annoying death rattles to deal with as well, and just constant pressure. And you know, the Tiger was really the key there. I think of just closing out the game. He did have Call the Wild, mm-hmm. but on turn 8. Your opponent can start to do stupid stuff as well.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, Crane was missing on very crucial cards, like the Doomsayer in early game, right? Even playing a Luthor on 2-2 would be really great, because he can trade with a minion and have a card draw at the same time, while having just the 1-1 kind of, you know, a little bit of help against a Firebat, right? But still, you would value the draw more than anything else.
Yep. Yeah, it's a tough one because the draw's super valuable, but also the fact that the Loot Hoarder can kill a lot of the Hunter minions is also super valuable as well. But
it's an Exot Hunter. That pushes the buttons for Warrior as well. I mean, you have a good matchup anyway, even without it, right?
Yeah.
But with Exot, you're just like crushing control decks.
Yeah, like after this set, I'm going to speak to Super JJ about this. So, because... This, I think, is just indicative of the format we're playing here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
N'Zoth Hunter is not something you would just rock up on ladder with, but when you can like very, very strongly control your opponent's lineup, then as you said, you know, the card's actually super powerful if you can aim towards these more control decks where Hunter's looking pretty decent anyway, and then when you have that one more card that can really just seal the deal, it's huge.
Yep.
But yeah, we, you know, we see Crane going onto the mage, and it is freeze, so good, I guess, right?
It is freeze mage, and it actually gets the best. I feel like this is the best minion that you can get out of Animal Companion on turn three against a freeze mage, because it's actually a huge minion. It requires a Frostbolt, and you can't ping it. Mm-hmm. But fortunately for JJ, he has his Novice Engineer on board, which helps him on this turn.
Yeah, I agree, though. A lot of the time, Huffer just does the nice 4 damage, but gets dealt with very easily.
Mm-hmm.
And now this is where it starts to get a little bit awkward for the freeze mages. This is one of the benefits of, you know, kind of Grandmother, where the 1-1 is kind of a pain. You're probably going to AoE at some point, and then you have to sort of maybe ping first, then deal with the 3-2 after. So makes it a little bit more awkward. Crane uses Arcane Intellect there to cycle through, but just has a whole lot of nothing at the moment.
Yep. And you can't really use the Icelands for now. It is more important to have it as a clear after the Blizzard, an example, or just stop the bleeding from Svanheimin for one turn.
Yeah, I mean, at first it's like, oh, you know, drawing a 6 drop on 5 when you have nothing else to play, not great. But when you can chain high mains against freeze mage, then you're feeling pretty good, especially when as long as the freeze mage is under enough pressure, you can just Nuzoth to get them both back later on. It's pretty scary.
Yep. The problem for JJ will be the fact that Crane has 4 turns of freeze. 4 turns. 2 Blizzards and 2 Frost Novas. What he just needs to find as a kind of like the second part of the clear, right? So let's say Doomsayer would be really awesome with one of the Frost Novas. And but in general, he's stalling enough probably to get the value done.
Yeah, I really like the play there. It's kind of cool. Normally, you don't play a minion before you kill off the Toad, because you don't want the 1 damage on a minion. But when that minion is Acolyte and it can draw you another card, you for sure want the damage. So it kind of worked out pretty well for Crane there, getting a sort of free cycle for something he was going to do anyway.
Yeah,
so it's kind of nice.
Touch a really cool topic, because the 1 ping is actually really cool to think about it. Most of the hunters are not playing Unleash the Hounds or playing just 1 copy. So when you're playing a class like Rogue, an example, when every single point of health has really huge value, you can think about playing a minion that can be damaged by what point and not make a difference. So let's say when a minion has 2 HP, right? If it has 1 or 2, makes no difference, because Quickshot is 3 damage, Kill Command is either 3 or 5, the bow is 3 damage, or most of the minions from Hunter are dealing 3.
Also, in
more.
This format specifically, this Hunter is clearly built to beat more control decks. You know, this is not built to be more aggressive decks that can are more token based, for example, and can get those 1 damage off. So I completely agree. Super cool deck building here. And we see the injured Valdir come off the camel, and that is a very threatening board here. But as you said, Crane does have a hell of a lot of freeze coming up now. It's just going to be how he chooses to sequence this. I imagine he'll want to combo a Blizzard with Thalnos next turn, potentially. So we might see him try and set something up here to make that a bit more powerful.
So Frost Nova and Doomsayer?
Yeah,
Frost Nova, Doomsayer, you can ping. Let's count the damage. What is possible for the next turn? If you go for the Bloodmage Thalnos next turn, he's actually going this turn. Interesting. Okay, so he saves the mana. Essentially, what he does here, he saves the mana for the Thalnos next turn so he can chain a Blizzard and ping. Because most likely, that's my guess, there will be no answer to the Thalnos if the Doomsayer is being killed. And he also... Oh my god. Just wanted to say that the Thalnos is also a great way of playing around Deadly Shot.
The responses from the players there. JJ's like, yep. And then Crane's just laughing away like, okay, you got me. You deadly shotted the 1 in 3 to kill off the Doomsayer, and this is progressively more scary. But Crane does have, as we said, that double Blizzard to stall out the game. The frustration will be the second Blizzard that will kind of have to combo with ping to, because it will generate the tokens from the wolves, which then can start to attack.
Now the Blizzard is not really that great because it generates 4 attack.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, 3 attack because it can ping one of the minions.
You can just trade the Thalnos off into the high main or something if you want.
You can.
You
but
know,
then
to
you
stop
don't
that
kill.
Happening, but exactly, yeah. It's like a.
You
don't get the benefit.
Kill,
yeah.
You need to kill the wolves at some point, right? So that's a problem. And in this situation, it's really hard to navigate here. You're at 18.
I mean, he can Blizzard and then ping a token, trade a token, and then the other there'll just be the two tokens that go into the mirror image.
Yeah, but the mirror image then is gone. I mean, having the mirror image as a failsafe is very important. I feel like it gives you at least 3 HP. That's a lot. For half a mana, that's a really cool value, right? He goes in for the trade. Blizzard and ping one of the minions, which leaves the mirror image alive, right?
Yeah. Oh?
But wait, what?
Oh, no.
Okay. So is it a bluff?
What's he bluffing, though?
Arcane Explosion?
Really?
it's like I'm asking, why would
you... Yeah, I was gonna say, is that the stretch we're going for here?
Why would you not kill one of the 1/1s to save the mirror image? I'm really trying to find the answer.
Is his plan Frost Nova next turn? Frost Nova Thorison?
Oh, I know why.
Yeah.
If you would had... No, that makes no sense. No.
I think it's because he was never playing on Blizzden this turn.
Was he playing around Animal Companion? To make less space for it?
Maybe, but you just didn't need to ping it, right? Interesting. I mean, I'm not the best Freeze Mage player in the world, so...
Neither am I.
Yeah, maybe there's something we missed there. But he was never going to Blizzard anyway, so the ping didn't really... You know, there was no need to ping anywhere else to set up a better Blizzard for the following turn.
Maybe you're right.
Now he can't ping the wolf, though, and because the board's so full, it means that there's only one token going to be generated. Which doesn't change
that
too much when he
blizzards
anyway. Yeah, it doesn't change too much, but double high main is frozen now, and the Emperor's still looking pretty safe here.
I mean, you have 12 damage in your hand. 15. So if you get a second Frostbolt, you actually win the game, right?
I think he's used both, right?
One was used on Dimisha, and was there a second one? I don't think so.
I might be wrong. I thought the second one was used, but hey, we'll see. And then we see N'Zoth come down now and just refill the board with so many death rattles.
2 ice block are being available for.
And 1 mana ice blocks as well.
Yeah.
Which is pretty
important.
I mean,
0 mana, right? If you don't trade.
Yeah, it will be now, yeah.
And you don't trade in this situation.
No, you can just finish the game. More than likely, you got to rely on just a little bit more burst to come out in the next turn or so. But he has so many turns now with the 2 ice blocks. There's 1 still active. And he can just play the other one next turn. And he's got double fireball in hand as well. So can he actually just ping him down over that amount of turns? He'll do 30. Yeah, he'll just... He'll do 13 next turn if he just fireball ping, if he draws no other burn.
Yep.
And then he can ping again. So then his opponent will be on 2. So he just needs anything at all to win this game in terms of burn.
And he has 2 turns for that.
And all the mana in the world.
Yep.
He can literally just...
Oh,
there we
that's
go.
It.
Yep.
2 mana, 2 fireballs. That's 12.
Seems pretty reasonable to me.
12 damage for 2 mana, yeah. That's what you see when there's Emperor going crazy on board and in the end.
Yeah, really cool game there. You know, we got to see Super JJ's pretty much anti-control hunter. But it just wasn't enough. Crane had so many freezes, as we said. Crane's early hand didn't look fantastic. But with double Frost Nova, double Blizzard, he just bought so many turns in which he could play. And Hunter's so minion-based that other than quick shots and kill commands... Mm-hmm. And the hero power over a few turns, I guess. There's not much just spell pressure to end the game, so...
He needed a flare or a secret eater.
Yeah.
Right, that would finish the game pretty fast, but that wasn't the case. So now we're left with Druid for JJ. If I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah, I think so. Should okay. be... Yeah, because you first picked Druid, right?
Yes, the first pick was Druid, and the first pick for Crane was Shaman.
Shaman, yeah.
And we didn't see the Shaman yet. So if JJ manages to win... this game, his final game will be against a Shaman, which is not an easy task with the Druid, but it's doable.
Yeah, I think we've seen that over yesterday that almost anything's doable with Druid anyway.
Oh my
so
god.
That's a reasonable sum of ramp.
Wait, do you go for the Fandral turn 1? Nah.
I don't know. Not versus Freeze Mage. I don't think. You're in no rush, right?
It's a 3 attack per turn. It's not easy killable. Your opponent will have to spend either multiple cards.
You've got follow-up of Wild Growth, to be fair. But I don't know. I think I just like the general ramp.
So coin Wild Growth turn 1. Interesting. Because that leaves you with 3 mana next turn. So you go for the hero power.
Yeah, I mean, it opens up the Living Roots, right?
Yeah. Actually, that's very very intelligent.
Mm-hmm. But now, you know, JJ's got off to a very quick start, but really has to make the most of his resources available now. He has only got Swipe, Feral Rage in hand. So Feral Rage, one of the key cards in this matchup, just casually gaining 8 armor is pretty useful versus Freeze Mage. So that's going to be pretty important here. And I imagine we're going to see it for armor in almost every single scenario here.
Yep.
And at the moment, Crane is just going to try and stem the tide, just get the mirror image down, ping off one of the 1/1 little saplings there, and make it a little bit more awkward for the druid to deal with these images.
Oh, Feral Rage is such a cool value here.
Yeah, do you hold off, though?
Interesting. Like, if you, let's say you use Nourish on turn 5, right? Because you have to.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a Fandral on board, which doesn't eat a fireball, then you use the...
And you want to nourish, right? Anyway, right?
Yeah, but even if it dies, you want to nourish, as you said. So then your Feral Rage loses the value out of it, so you don't push for the damage.
So the damage would only be, like, 3, right? Would it be 3? No, it would be 1. Because you still have to trade into
But you will use it for the heal in this matchup, most likely.
Yeah, that's true.
And you use the hero power instead. And you have to use the mana in the next turns.
Maybe there's a scenario where he might need Feral Rage to prop the block.
Maybe.
For the point of 1 damage, I don't mind holding on there. We see a couple of turns just whiz by there as the old Acolyte ping from the mage. Nothing too crazy. Crane just going to try and get as much cycle as possible, whereas JJ's, you know, drawing pretty well himself with that Nourish. An Arcane Giant, another pain. Just yet another card that makes this matchup very difficult for the mage. Cheap 8/8s out that the mage can't really deal with. Combine that with Maligos as well, that also we saw yesterday. The grand plan versus Freeze Mage was to just drop Maligos onto the board and say,
Deal with it.
Because you can't. Yeah. Do you randomly run Polymorph in your deck? Probably not.
And it's cool to see that Sylvanas probably will not be played until needed. Because you don't want to play the Sylvanas when your opponent can just give you a Doomsayer, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't want to develop a board with Sylvanas with it. So, but fortunately for him, he has other means, which are like, let's say, Arcane Giant, which is a huge pain for me to deal with. Because
and everything, he can just Maligos next turn.
Yeah, whatever you do, you need to deal 8 damage to kill that minion. Or just freeze it for infinite amount of turns. An example card like Ragnaros Firelord is actually beating the Freeze Mage on its own.
Yeah.
Because you play around freezes, and it's hard to deal with because it's 8 HP. So you need a Fireball and a Frostbolt. Or Frostbolt, Iceland's Ping, which is not convenient for the Mage.
And I really like the origin of this. The Arcane Giant coming out just before you can play Maligos is huge, because you'd imagine Fireballs are going to be used on the Arcane Giant. Not that Mage really has a good way to deal with Maligos in terms of spell damage anyway. We've already seen one Fireball come out into the Fandral early on.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no good way to deal with this AA. Crane's just going to Ice Barrier. Now weighing up whether he wanted to Ice Lance just to save the 8 damage this turn, but choosing to skip and... Yeah, we're just going to see Maligos, because what's Crane going to do?
You can ping it for 1.
Oh,
and
yeah,
then
yeah.
throw a Novus Engineer.
Do that 12 times, and you got him.
Ah, too bad he can use the Frost Nova for the Emperor Destin as well, but then it just dies to a Swipe, which deals 6 damage AoE and 9 damage to the face.
Yeah, that's the problem you have in this scenario. You can't kill Maligos, and you know the odds on your opponent having any spell that, you know, benefits from spell power, of course, is really high. And the second they can start chaining those, it's just game over.
By the way, you got the golden Maligos from your humble from your welcome pack, right?
Yep, it was awesome.
Yeah,
I got King Crush from the legendary you guaranteed. So Blizzard know I'm a hunter player, which is nice. And then open the packs, golden Mali.
Damn, I'm
it's
jelly.
The best, you should be.
Such a nice card.
Mm-hmm. We see Blizzard coming out to at least stop the damage from the minions, but...
Oh, wow. A Moonfire for 6 damage.
Yep.
So let's say, do you want to use the Swipe this turn? It's 15 damage to the face. There are no secrets yet.
I think as long as...
Feral Rages, that's 8. Is that lethal? It's 8-14-23 now.
Yeah, I think as long as you hold on to an answer to say Thorsen, I mean, honestly, I don't think it's going to matter because, mm-hmm. JJ is just so far ahead. It's not going to be a problem at all. But there's no reason to say, like, randomly Moonfire face now, I don't think. I don't think you're too afraid of the Maligos dying. So I like holding on there. You just hold on. There's no rush to do it. As I said, the odds on Maligos getting removed are pretty low, and the odds on both minions getting removed is extremely low, almost impossible.
And you don't want to use the Fireball on the Arcane Giant, because how do you win the game then?
I don't think you win the game at all at this point, but I do agree. With one Fireball already gone into the Fandral, you're very limited with even the craziest of options that could come out for Crane here.
So if you go for the Emperor and Frost Nova, it seems like the most logical option this turn. Because you, first of all, you will have access to more answers on turn 10. You also kind of stem the bleeding for one turn. Kills the Maligos.
Yeah, he's going to put everything into Maligos there. And that cost Crane a lot. Because now with double Feral Rage, like, how does he ever kill him?
Does he have a Maligos? Maligos. Oh my god. Archmage Antonidas in his deck.
I don't think so.
Because that would be the only option to get back the burn that he needs to kill his opponent, right? Even with an Alexstrasza dealing 15 damage here, and...
You just gain it all back in armor anyway.
You just get back with two Feral Rages.
And the problem as well is that there's just so many more threats. There's still another Arcane Giant for a start that he has to deal with. This one's still alive, and you've seen both Fireballs, Frostbolt now, so... Very limited options that can come out. Luckily, Crane does have the Blizzard and two Frost Novas available, so he can slow the minions down. So he's not completely out of it yet. Doomsayer, pretty decent draw to be able to put on a huge threat of this board clear coming out now that JJ will actually just have to answer. Because you don't really want to lose this 8-6, not after seeing both Fireballs.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about why JJ didn't use the Moonfire back then, right? It was 6 damage to the face. Now it's less.
Yeah.
I mean, I can understand why
it's whether you wanted to hold removal for a Doomsayer.
So, Feral Rage is 4 damage. And a Living Roots, it's 3. Either or, you just use the Modifier and Hero Power. He goes for the Living Roots.
Yeah, he's going to use the Moonfire to clear up the Acolyte as well, so still representing a pretty scary board. But again, we see just another game where Crane has all the freezes he could ever want. And the Feral Rage got used as an attack not for armor, which is actually super important.
It is key in this matchup, but still one Feral Rage more is available.
And also, we can imagine JJ has access to two Raven Idols as well. So,
but no more Fandral.
No, true. But you're really just looking for Feral Rages or Moonglade Portals or something just to really close out the game.
Emperor Frost Nova and Archon Intellect is available for the next turn. So will we see another Feral Rage being used as an attack? I guess so, because you need to deal with the Emperor. You just can't leave it open for 2 turns. A Yogg!
Why not?
Oh my god!
I think he needs the Feral Rage for armor. I think that's the issue. You've used one. Yep. I don't think you can use two. So it's going to be Maelstrom Portal starting off. Injured Kvaldi.
Oh, wow.
Pretty good pick. Well, pretty good pick. He didn't choose it, but you know what I mean.
But that would have been great if those minions wouldn't be frozen.
This is the only problem with doing a Yogg on a board this when your side of the board is this big, is that a lot of the directional or aimed spells are more than likely going to hit your own minions. But this is looking pretty okay.
Oh,
Yogg.
Well, he got the Emperor from the convert.
Solemn Vigil looking pretty good as well. Always good to have card draw as long as you're not fatigued or actually burning cards. So that Yogg getting some work done as well. Even swings in for 5. There's Ice Barrier. Not that Ice Barrier is going to make too much of an impact in this matchup.
I mean, this Yogg was ridiculous.
Yeah.
You still have your board.
Did a pretty good job.
Like, what
even
the hell?
Even though he polymorphed himself.
This Yogg was really great. When you consider... Okay, let's count it like that. You use your 10 mana to get 2 traps, right? You get 2 traps, which are... Actually, what traps are there is not that important. it's the bluff factor, also taking a really huge part of the game. And then you spawned a 2/4 minion, which is worth 3 mana, and then you had an option to kill your opponent's minion and deal 5 damage to the face with your own minion, and you did draw 4 cards.
Pretty successful.
10 mana for that, and you didn't lose your biggest minions on board, apart from Yogg.
Mm.
It's pretty sweet.
Yeah, and this Arcane Giant is still alive. It's not going anywhere. And now an Ancient of War is just going to be even more trouble. And there we go. The uproot. Why not? You've seen so much removal. Like, what's going to do the 5 damage? Well, Roaring Torches for a start. But again, if all this removal is being used on the minions, then how does the Druid ever even die at this point?
No way of dying at all. And you can still have Ice Block. Actually, what was the secret for Mage?
It was Ice Barrier.
Oh, Ice Barrier.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, might come into effect with Alexstrasza a little bit, but that's the only realistic outcome, I think, unless Crane's running anything too crazy. But Crane not normally known for running anything too wild in his decks. He likes more of the standard tried and tested lists.
Yep. Oh, well, what can you do? That is really like last resort stuff for Crane. He's emptying his hand. He's killing the threads, but the threads will be coming all the time. Just thread after thread after thread, and they might not be an 8/8 or a 10/5 or might be 10/5, but...
Please, JJ, uproot again.
A 5/5 minion on board is actually a pretty big a deal for the Freeze Mage to deal with.
Yeah, he's going to do it again. He saw Crane had no good answer to the first one. Why not make another 10/5?
Mm-hmm.
Sure. And I feel like JJ's just bullying Crane out of the game now. JJ's still holding on to the Fel Rage, so at worst, he can instantly heal for 8 or gain 8 armor. More or less the same thing.
Does Alexstrasza, but the damage is low. You only have 6.
Oh, and there's Raven Idol as well. Really nice pickup.
So Raven Idol for heal. Let's see if he'll get it. You can keep the Alexstrasza on board for 1 attack. You don't care. You have Ice Barrier.
Hmm. It's power though. Oh, okay. I suppose the Living Roots is a way to proc block from hand. I was just waiting at the Power of the Wild to make the board truly ridiculous. Okay, he's just going to focus on procing the block at 1.
Well, he needs to, right, this turn. He needs to proc it this turn, that's for sure. But it's the Feral Rage, healing for 8, puts him out of range of almost everything that can happen with 3 cards.
We've already seen pretty much all the burn that's left here that's been used in the deck anyway, so...
We can see a second Roaring Torch, so that's 12. So that's the armor, basically. Oh, wow. This is not looking good for Crane.
Is there even anything in
his
deck?
No,
there we go. I was going to say, not too surprised to see Crane concede there. There's literally nothing in the deck left that could even get anything done, so... I think JJ just playing a very standard match there. You know, nothing too crazy went on. The Yogg got a lot of work done, but I feel that Super JJ was in a pretty good position anyway.
Yeah, from the beginning, I feel like drawing out the Fireball for the Fandral was actually really impactful in the game, since the Fandral was either... If you don't kill it, you get infinite value from the... Raven Idol, an example. Mm-hmm. It might be actually infinite, right? Because you get a minion, you get another Raven Idol.
The most I Raven Idoled is 4 times, I think. I think that's the most I got. And
that's
I was
ridiculous.
Literally picking it just to see if it would keep going. But I managed it 4 times. That's the most. If anyone has beaten that record, let me know.
But you need to have a proof.
Yeah.
You're saying I had it 12 times, that doesn't work.
I had it 100 times. Yeah, okay. Okay, we are in what will be the last game of this series. The first series of the day, Super JJ versus Crane 2-2. It's going to be Druid versus Shaman.
Raven Idol turn 1 for a spell, I'm guessing.
Straight for the Nourish. Not too much of a surprise. Normally, with the hand, if you forget about the Innovate, Nourish wouldn't really feel like a good pick there, just because your hand is very slow. But with the Innovate, you can actually just really accelerate into the ramp and get ahead, which is what the rest of his hand kind of leans towards. The Ancient of War and the Swipe already.
Totem Goal is presenting a big threat for the beginning of the game, especially when he can curve out into something for one mana and he has the Spirit Glow. Although he would rather have a minion for one mana since he has a Flaming Totem in hand, and that will allow him to stack up the damage faster. Oh my god, double innervates, but will he go for it when he might actually know that Kryn is running a hex? I don't know if he's running the hex, but JJ
well,
has.
Is he gonna innovate, nourish, innovate? He could even innovate swipe.
Oh, yeah, right. I think he's actually going for that.
Just weighing up how. The problem is, next turn he's on 6, which 6 doesn't really do much else for him anyway, whereas having the innovate next turn for potential like Azure Drake and then having the 3 mana spare with the innovate might be more valuable than just swiping a Totem Golem. I mean, he's so far ahead in mana now. The Totem Golem getting an attack in this turn, fine. You know, he's probably going to be able to deal with it there.
Mm-hmm. How do you like Spirit Claw, by the way?
I really like it. I didn't think it would be anywhere near as good as it is, to be honest. When I looked at it, it looked like an interesting weapon, but nothing too crazy. Because, let's be honest, Shaymin has Doomhammer. You know, why do you care about Spirit Claws? But actually, the amount of times you can get that spell power, either the spell power totem or just build your deck in a way that makes spell power more doable on demand. So we've seen like more Azure Drake's Thalnos be played in the, like mid-range variants, for example. Mm-hmm. Just to be able to turn the weapon on and having 3 charges of a potential 3 attack weapon for 1 mana, it's kind of nuts.
Yeah, that's true. The only problem I have with this card is the fact that you rely so much on your hero power to hit the correct minion. Alright, and that's the problem for me. But in general, I feel like it's a sweet card, and maybe if someone will have more impactful weapons other than Doomhammer, then maybe we'll not see Doomhammer anymore.
Yeah, I think as well, to be fair to Spirit Claws, like, a lot of the time, the 1 damage is okay. You know, if you just need the 1 damage to finish off a minion, you know, it's still fairly flexible, especially in the aggro matchups where a lot of minions have 1 health.
So, Light's Justice with upside.
Well, there you go. There you go. Oh, Light's Justice. I've not seen you in a long time.
Yeah, we lost a specific card for Paladin that was for 3 mana.
Yeah.
What was the name of it? Call to Arms, right?
Mustafa Battle.
Mustafa Battle, right. Call to Arms. Now we have, like, Stand Against Darkness, right?
Which is the 5 tokens, right? Not quite as good as Muster, though. We are going to see the Rock Biter used here to clear up. That is your Drake. And now Kryn is actually presenting quite a frustrating board for JJ to try and deal with here. Oh.
This is what I was thinking, maybe.
Do you Fandral Innovate Nourish here? Just because of the raw power of that combo.
I think so.
Like, yeah, you know, all you end up doing is you draw cards, you gain some mana to go back up to 5.
I mean, you get the innervate back.
Yeah.
So you get 3 mana, 3 cards, which is a good deal. Mm-hmm. And you can still use a ref for 4. That's actually amazing.
Yep, that is pretty nice. And even as well, being able to, if he feels he needs to, if he's under that much pressure, he can actually just slam the Yogg next turn because of the ramp. Mm-hmm. Look at the difference in mana.
4 mana to 10? It's kind of sick.
So ridiculous. Okay.
But I was thinking that maybe using double innervate instead of the nourish back then, maybe it was better because if you know, this is the key here. If Kryn is running 2 hexes, then that would be a terrible move. But if he's not running those, maybe it was actually more impactful to have a big minion on board that would take the board control back, right?
Yeah.
And then you can ramp slowly, but steadily, because you have board control.
Yeah, I imagine Kryn is running 2 hex, though. He's playing this mid-range variant we can see from the Thunderbluff. Mm-hmm. And even the Primal Fusion, that, you know, this is more than likely going to be mid-range. There's a hex, as we talk about. But yeah, it's very similar to the way you play versus Warrior, right? You don't try and ramp into a huge minion early a lot of the time because an execute just completely ruins your day.
Yep, that's true. That's true. Swipe will have some impact on the board, and you have Moonfire and Living Roots to kind of clean up the board. Are you able to clean everything? You can clean Flamethrower Totem. Yes, everything is being cleaned off.
Yeah, and I really like this. Versus mid-range, if you can clear the whole board late game, it's normally relatively difficult for the shaman to actually build the board back up again, you rely on having a board like pretty full of totems so you can really benefit from Thunderbluff or Primal Fusion. And maybe if Cranes were in a Bloodlust, I don't know, but you know, Bloodlust as well to just have that extra threat available. And I really like just reducing the board down as much as possible and then sort of asking the shaman, like, can you refill this board quickly enough? And the answer a lot of the time is actually no.
Taunt Totem. Unfortunately, he was fishing for the spell portal and to buff up his weapon so he can clean up the Azure Drake with the Milestone Portal.
Could have even double portaled if he got spell power.
This is painful. The hex will be needed in the upcoming turn.
Well, that's Sylvanas as well.
Well, that did work out for Super JJ really well, because now the Engine of War will just soak 10 damage without the access to the second hex.
Yeah. And Engine of War, like, I was going to say, the only thing to at least think about for a second is if Azure Drake was hexed, is it because you have the other hex? You know, and you're like, oh, you know, I can afford to use this one, but I still think Ancient of War is the correct play here. And he's got such good follow-up as well. The Fel Rage, even better, you know, just to... He was under a little bit of health pressure here, but the combination of Ancient of War and Fel Rage means it's been way, way safe. And he's got Yogg for those shenanigans that are more than likely going to happen a little bit later on.
That's correct. By the way, he's playing two Spirit Claws.
Yeah, I like it. Spirit Claws are good.
The power to kill the Thunderbluff Valiant. It's really not looking good for Crane.
Yeah, seeing the hex onto the Azure Drake. Well, now, yeah, it would have been frustrating if the Ancient War got the second hex. But now there's two targets that kind of need to be dealt with. And he's just going to start stacking up from there for JJ. So Crane, a really rough position. He has all the AoE he could ever want.
But he's lacking the air power totem, which would add 3 damage AoE to
the
spells.
And the frustration as well is you can't even really trade away the board and let Sylvanas steal nothing because Maelstrom Portal summons summons minions, so it's kind of frustrating in that. And normally it's fantastic, but I suppose you're only giving your opponent a 1 drop at best.
Second Feral Rage, that's actually a lot of damage.
Yeah.
Still not enough to kill.
Or even
opponent.
Just a hell of a lot of health to stabilize.
Yeah.
Like, if you're scared. And there's Maligos. Not going to do too much in the way of spell damage at the moment because there's nothing to actually cast. But I kind of agree with JJ on this. Just drop Maligos. Now you have a War, Sylvanas, and Maligos on the board. Like, how's your opponent dealing with all this when you've already seen a hex?
Yep. And you know that your opponent is playing a kind of clunky version with the Primal Fusions. So I like it a lot. Still no air power totem. Unlucky.
Yeah, this is getting progressively more rough for Crane. Just not quite getting exactly what he needs. A Maelstrom Portal does. Gets a trog. Okay, that's reasonable at least. In before Sylvanas steals it.
Yeah. That will happen for sure. 100%.
Wait, he even has to run a mint. So you run the Divine Shield in, right?
I guess so.
Because you don't care if you don't want the Divine Shield to be stolen. It's like the priority here is like Tunnel Trog into Argent Squire is the choice for Sylvanas,
yep.
I guess. Ooh, okay, you got the totem. So best outcome actually.
I suppose the best outcome
is Squire now
the
because of the shield's
Squire
gone. Yeah.
And because of the Primal Fusion.
Exactly, yeah.
7 damage, Living Roots, is that lethal? Nope.
I mean you could just Living Roots to 5/5, right?
Yep.
Play the Maya Keeper and if he wants to, just Fel Rage for armor, or he can remove the Trog and just go face with Maligos. You know, JJ has a lot of options here. I feel like he's very, very safe, especially because he has the last resort, which I feel what Yogg should be called. Not Hope's End, last resort. It's something no one really wants to do, but you get forced into it.
So would you like to use one for a Rage for the heal? I don't think so, because you can 8, 12, 12. You can actually finish up the game next turn if you use both Feral Rages for damage, but can you die against this Shaman with 2 cards at 15?
There's some lists that are running like a Lava Burst, but at this health, I don't think you can with this board so small. But as I said earlier, JJ is so far ahead, why not just be like super safe? There's like make it actually just zero way for me to lose this game. Because to be fair, if a second hex comes out onto the Maligos, then
you have to use Yogg.
Yeah, but then you're relying on Yogg, whereas maybe you're in a bit of trouble with low health. Whereas at least if you have more armor, it's very unlikely that Yogg is going to do anything detrimental to you.
Correct. So now he wants to fish for a swiping example.
Swipe would be insane. Ravenider wouldn't be bad either, because I think he's only used one this game. Just going to go for the get the Mire Keeper, which is fine. You can just go wider on the board again. Just create issues that Crane has to try and deal with. And now Crane down to just having one card a turn, and this is not what he needs in this position.
Seems. Oh my god, is he playing Wicked Witch Doctor? Are you serious?
Yeah, this is the version of the deck I play. It's great. I love Witch Doctor.
But it seems to be, even with two Milestone Portals and Lightning Storms, it seems to be having hard times to get back on board with all the spare part of
that's
them, right?
That's the problem. So with that deck, you kind of rely on the power of getting on board and staying there. With you, I imagine there's cards like Totemic Might, for example, you know, to really make your board stick and then build off that. So yeah, cool series overall. Really close one. I expected nothing less from these guys.
Yeah, definitely. And I kind of like that Druid, like Maligos is back in the Druid, and it seems like Druid is super powerful. And the metagame also changed. Like Karazhan didn't introduce that many cards, but it did influence the deck building. And we see those new decks for Shaman, for Druid, Maligos is back, and other classes have been influenced as well. So even though we don't see that many new archetypes, the old archetypes are changing drastically.
Yeah, you just gotta look at cards like Arcane Giant, right? Yep. Like a huge impact, even though, you know, as you said, there isn't tons of Karazhan cards being played at the moment. Just Arcane Giant alone makes so many decks even more viable.
Let's see some best plays of the match then.
That first match, Rogue versus Paladin, I believe like JJ really assumed that he's going to win this one. But losing was a bit tough. Still, he was able to climb back with the Druid, but this is something you definitely expect to win, right, Raven?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. At least the matchups I've played with it, I think I've always felt like the Rogue has a decent shot. Because you just continue to make like awkward boards to clear, but we saw that Crane with the Consecrated Pyro early on actually had a decent way to deal with most of the board. So he did take the win, but see now that the Hunter, the N'Zoth Hunter as well, definitely I think aimed towards beating those heavy control decks. And here's the Deadly Shot Snipe onto the Doomsay, which really helped out, because otherwise the whole board would be, well, not the whole board, the first wave of the board before the Death Rattles would be cleared.
Yeah, but even
would have gave Crane the option to actually, you know, move forward even further with the Blizzard follow-up.
Yeah.
Even though it helped out, still, Crane played it beautifully to win versus the Hunter, because with so many minions, normally Mage has trouble dealing with as many high minions on the board, but Crane was able, even without Alexstrasza, to actually deal enough damage and then set up a kill with Thorisson hits and those fireballs in hand.
Yeah, we saw so many chain freezes. The, you know, Hunter, obviously, especially the version JJ was playing so minion heavy, that there just wasn't really much burst to try and even threaten lethal. Even though we can see that Crane was at 2 health at the end, he still had the ice spot to gain another turn, and he needed pretty much any damage available to end this game.
He had infinite health.
Yep.
For one turn. Like a superhero power.
Okay, so and now we see just like
this is the ridiculous Yogg. Look at it. Look at this.
Let's just sit and look at Yogg.
And this doesn't matter. You kill your own minion, it doesn't really matter. You still keep your entire board with
Bloodlust 8-6. Looks fancy, at least.
Yeah,
it seemed to me that JJ had an advantage in this game overall with double Feral Rage, just getting that extra health and just keeping a big board as well. This is something that Prismage has traveled to deal with, and if you also can gain health. This matchup is a bit weird. I'm still not sure who has an edge, but Druid definitely can get those cards that will give him
I think Druid just crushes this matchup, although a lot of the time, unless something goes like terribly wrong on the Druid end, this should be a pretty straightforward one. Just because, as we saw earlier from this point, there was the Arcane Giant and Maligos on the board for JJ. It's like, what does the Freeze Mage do?
Right,
it's like,
with just Maligos.
Cry. Yeah, you just play Maligos and be like,
I agree with
enjoy.
You. I was mostly referring to like the even move out at Arcane Giants, like the version before Karazhan, but after Karazhan, definitely Arcane Giants, they do push it in favor of Druid.
I really wonder why Blizzard released an Arcane Giant when they just nerfed Molten Giants, right? They seem to be kind of very similar to each other.
Yeah, I think Arcane Giant requires a bit more more sort of deck building thoughts, really. But we have JJ here. Congratulations on the win. It was a close series.
Yeah, against a really good friend and teammate, I guess. Yeah. Was a good series, yeah.
But he didn't kick him out of the tournament yet. He's now in the lower bracket, so he has a chance to actually get back to you in the grand final.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's true.
So, what can you tell us? When did you start with Rogue?
I thought it was not really important in this series. Like, it's nice to have, but it was not really like, maybe it was nice to queue in the pattern, but I had two good decks against the pattern anyway, so it was like, yeah, throw the Rogue out. And I think Rogue is in a really bad spot at the moment. It's pretty inconsistent, and even Murloc pattern, yeah, is, I think it's stronger. Like, it's not as one-sided anymore as it used to be, with the, especially with the Ivory Knight, which shields you and gives you resources.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And but you had the knowledge what this time, what did it give, right? Because it was heal for zero.
Yeah, I knew.
So it was like, oh, okay, now I know that he has the access to the heal at some point of the game for sure.
Yeah,
100%,
exactly.
Right?
So JJ, during the game, you were showing a lot of emotions, like just swearing.
Oh, I
heard you shout.
What happened there?
I had to go to the toilet all the time, and I was like, I was like,
you should have gone before we started.
I was, but I drank too much coffee in the morning, and I was like, oh fuck. Yeah, and it even pressured me more, and I was like, oh.
You pulled the rein out then.
Well, yeah. You know, still worked out in the end. Just a quick question, like the Hunter. With Nazarth, is it just really you going full whack against beating control decks?
You just beat the control decks.
Yeah, and we were just saying, like, this is kind of the cool thing about this tournament format is that you can really drive a list in a certain direction because you can almost pin your opponent into certain picks that, you know, the deck's specifically going to perform against.
I mean, you see the life coach deck, this especially, like the Rogue without Auctioneer and stuff like that. You have to do it, right? You have to, like, find a strategy that works.
And have you, like, after bouncing picks, have you felt comfortable versus Crane? Have you thought that you won the bouncing picks, or were you behind?
Every time I have my Druid, I'm happy.
I wonder if people will start banning Druids.
I don't know what's wrong with them. Like,
yeah, I mean, it was speaking to some of the guys yesterday, and they were saying, like, one of the issues is if you've come into the tournament and knowing what your first ban's always going to be to then build your lineup to deal with everything else, and then suddenly everyone's crushing with Druid and you change the ban, then your lineup might be weaker overall to the class you've left open that you were going to ban. But to be honest, I would just be very afraid of Druid and ban it every time.
It's
just ridiculous. We've seen it just in this tournament. We've known it's been a good deck for a while.
Yeah.
There's a lot of players that are bringing it and performing very well. But even just this tournament, I think it's been overperforming for everyone.
Like, even this version for Druid is, for me, pretty new, so I'm not really playing it super well. I had a very the Power of the Wild version, I was more comfy with it. Like, here it's very hard when to use the Living Roots, the spells. Mm-hmm. You have to ban it, right? Like,
yeah, it seems it's definitely performing really well, where Shaman is underperforming, I believe, like, because we haven't seen Shaman being that successful yesterday.
Well, we didn't see the other groups, and I heard that in the other groups, Shaman was wrecking people.
Ty's
got actually 6-0'd.
Oh, were both matches?
Both
matches
were lost
to
Shaman.
I knew one of them was.
All right, so maybe we'll see some Shaman actually doing well in this tournament. So congratulations again, JJ. Now we will have some time to prepare for the next match. And for you guys, the next match is going to be Hoi versus Orange. We'll prepare the players and be right back.